Congratulations. You found the Twin Cities Hit Show with Rusty, Courtney, and Chuck.
Say, where's Chuck? He was sitting right here beside me when I fell asleep, and now he's gone. We'd better look for him.
Very well. Where do I begin?
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention?
Reach for this one.
And now, a real hit show.
You're in love with Chuck, aren't you, sir?
Me? Me in love with Chuck? How could anybody ever be in love with boring, dull, wishy-washy old Chuck?
Live from the Twin Cities, it's the Twin Cities Hit Show.
Chuck, come back! I didn't mean it! I didn't know you were listening! Chuck!
Let's get this hit show started.
Alrighty then.
We got it. We got it sorted.
I saw that. It was like the plane was about to crash, but you plugged in the headset just in time.
Yeah, thank you. Thank
that
you.
That was amazing work. Hey, welcome to the Twin Cities Hit Show. I'm Rusty Gadenby.
I'm Courtney McLean.
And there is no Chuck.
Oh, where's Chuck?
He's on vacation with his girlfriend.
Ooh, they're in New England.
They're in Boston.
In Boston. Boston.
So let's talk about Chuck while he's not here real
quick. Yeah, absolutely.
Do you like Chuck?
I love Chuck, but I, you know how I have a hard time with Chuck sometimes, but deep down inside.
Do you feel an emptiness today without Chuck here?
A little bit. It's a thin line between love and hate. It's a thin line. Yeah.
Do we have a quarter? We can decide right now. Do we love or hate this guy? We've got a quarter. Our guests are here. Tim Mahoney is joining us once again.
Thank you for having me, Rusty.
Hi,
you love Chuck.
He was abrasive at first, but yeah, I like him now. I do. I think he's a nice guy.
I think our guest from the Minnesota Department of Tourism may find you a bit abrasive before the show. Alyssa Ebel.
Working on it.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi,
Alyssa. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you for
having me. Things are getting exciting in the world of tourism for Minnesota, right?
Very exciting. It's a big business in Minnesota. It's a $13 billion business.
And whoa.
We are excited to kick off the summer travel season.
$13
billion.
Are you okay
with
Tim? He was being a little awkward before the show. Tim, are you all right?
I'm good.
You brought your dog in.
I did. I brought my puppy, Loli, as a guest. I thought you guys might like her.
Does Loli speak?
Not really.
No. Oh, okay.
Not really.
She just looks adorable.
She does like girls more. So
oh, yeah?
I thought there'd be some, just a smell or something.
I like dogs more than I like people, so.
You know what I like?
That works.
I like your dog more than I like you.
Oh! See? I knew that. I could sense something was going awry before we got
out. He walks right into it, really. I mean.
I do. Can I work on it, like, through the show?
I'm excited to meet Chuck.
Yeah. Ouch. Chuck will be up at the fishing opener.
I will not be there. I have my own show, though. Do you know that?
I don't.
Maybe you could be a guest on that show. No. You're going to say no. I'm walking right into that one.
I'm busy fishing.
Washing your hair.
Let's talk about fishing.
She's busy fishing. Now, we're just a couple of weeks away, right?
Two.
Exactly 2 weeks from today, the governor's fishing opener will kick off on Lake Vermilion. It is the 68th annual fishing opener.
Wow.
It's been going on since 1948.
Wait, so next year is going to be year 69.
Oh, you would go there. Good Lord.
All right, sorry.
Sexualizing fishing.
I'll be back next year.
Explain for people who haven't been to the governor's fishing opener, why should they go to the governor's fishing opener?
Well, the governor's fishing opener, it's a time-honored tradition. It's actually a media event, and most of the events within the event are for media, stakeholders, and dignitaries to really kind of showcase the area. It's not necessarily all of it is open to the public. However, one component of the event is the community picnic, which is a big, massive celebration. You've been to the community picnic at the governor's
free
fishing
food.
Opener. Yeah, free food, free event.
Oh.
It's a great event for the public to kind of get out there and showcase their community, and it's just a big, it's a celebration to summer.
What about the little burn dance? Is that open to the public?
Yes, the barn dance is happening on Thursday evening before the fishing opener. And it goes from 7 to 9, a little later if people are really kicking it.
All right.
So that is happening at White Eagle Resort on Lake Vermilion.
Do the women wear big, like, petticoats? And like crinolines under their dresses?
I have not attended this barn dance yet, but I'm very excited. I think we can, Rusty and I can do the waltz.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll wear that petticoat. What are you talking about?
What band is playing for the
Rolling Stones.
I do not know of the band, but I know it's a great, it's a regular event at the White Eagle Resort on Lake Vermilion. It happens every Thursday night. It's not just for the fishing opener.
Gotcha.
But
it happens every Thursday night.
It does, yes. This is just a good example of kind of the quirky little things that happen around the Lake Vermilion area. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, it's a fun way to kind of kick off the season.
Well, yeah, totally. If you needed any banjo, Courtney is a banjo player. She would fit right in
she's
at that,
that
there.
Good, but she's good.
I'm not that good.
Ding dong, babe.
No? You're saying no? You're passing on the banjo?
I would like to learn how to play the banjo.
Oh, well, I could teach you basics.
We could do that while we are fishing.
Yeah, sure. Out on the in the boats.
Yes.
On the boats.
And does,
on
it, about in the
does
boat.
The governor the actually the fish?
The governor does fish. He loves to fish. And okay. he's determined to catch a big one this year, and he's determined to beat the new lieutenant governor.
How's his record been? Do we know? I forget. Has he been successful?
Yes, he has. My first year at the Governor's Fishing Opener up in Park Rapids, he caught a walleye at 12:26 a.m.
Whoa.
So I think he was the first one in the state to catch a fish that year.
And then I ran into him at the Waconia one. I was disappointed at the Waconia one. I'm like, it should be up north. Why are we in Waconia?
Because Minnesota is, we have nearly 12,000 lakes in Minnesota, and we want
Wait,
to showcase
12,
all of them.
12,000?
Yes.
Yeah, we're not. 10,000 is just
the
logo.
It's sort of a false fact. You 10, know, land 000, of 10,000 lakes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually nearly 11,842 to be exact. I haven't
I'm
counted
tweeting that
recently.
Right now.
Yeah, yeah. Only in MN. Make sure you use the hashtag only in MN.
Oh, okay.
That's what we need to get the word out.
11,842
lakes in Minnesota.
How is it decided where the opener goes?
Every year, any community in Minnesota is allowed to put a bid in for it. And if they want to put in the work to kind of showcase their area and... it's a year, and actually it's more than a year of planning this event.
Yeah.
So if they're ready and up for it, it's a great way to, it's a great publicity opportunity for the area and a great way to kick off the summer travel season. Mm-hmm. So really anybody can participate. They just have to submit a bid.
Minnetonka's never hosted, though. One of the
Not
big...
that I'm aware of.
Because that's a good fishing lake.
It is a great fishing lake. All of these lakes in Minnesota are great fishing lakes. No, I mean, we are one of the largest fishing destinations in the U.S., second
not
to Alaska.
Lake, not the lake my dad and I go to every year. And what's sad is we keep going back to that same lake.
To Lake Minnetonka?
No. We go up north out of Hackensack every year. We have a father-son fishing trip, and we never really have good luck. But we're so dumb, we keep going back to the same cabin in the same lake.
But that's what's like, fun. Minnesota is about tradition and those summer getaways, so that's okay.
Yeah. When I
and it's not just the fishing, it's father-son time.
Absolutely. It's funny when I tell people, I got a father-son fishing trip. Oh, you're Reed and Connor going with
me?
I go, no, I'm the son. I'm going with my dad.
That is so, that's so sweet. I grew up in Southern California, so I didn't do any of this stuff. So it's like, I don't know. It's so
See,
great
you're
going to
miss
about.
Out. She's going to be performing.
I'm going to be performing.
She took a gig at the Varsity Theater on May 7th.
Huh?
Getting paid?
Yeah.
It's so good.
Yeah. And it's also at the Varsity, which we've never played
the
before.
The Varsity Theater is
great.
They have one of the best bathrooms in the country.
Oh, I've been to the Varsity. Yeah.
That's a good
They're
point.
Beautiful. Yes. It's beautiful
it's an
bathrooms.
Accolade. I've actually never seen it, but they have I forget what publication it was, but it was a national publication that voted them the best bathroom in the U.S.
It's
okay.
confusing because Focus they're kind of like, you know, like the men's and the guys have the same wash area a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, so it's one of those. You ever been to Chino Latino?
I have.
House, you kind of look through and is that weird? You
Let's
know?
Take it back to fishing.
So I was trying to do an audio prompt there. Here we go.
So what is the deal? Okay. Are walleyes like the most difficult fish to catch?
No.
Just seem like, it seems like it's a big deal if somebody gets a walleye here. Or is it just because walleyes
because
are...
It's our state fish.
It's our state fish?
It's our state
okay.
fish
and it's good eating.
Yeah.
And to this point, you can't catch and eat them right now. Opener is when you can now... start to catch and eat them.
The official walleye season on Saturday, May 9th.
Yeah.
What's considered a big size of a walleye?
Oh, my gosh. That's a really good question for Rusty. Yeah.
No, well, the size changes for the DNR on what you can keep and eat. But
depending on how aroused you are.
Because we were talking beforehand.
I'm sorry.
I've been on
I'm
a fishing
sorry,
trip with my dad, and I caught... a large, and I said it wrong. I said stuffed, mounted. I guess they don't.
Loli just talked.
I had an opinion about that.
I don't
you
know
said
if they
heard don't
that.
Do
She's
that
trying
anymore.
To tell you that most people get replicas of their walleye.
These days, yeah. Yes. You can just show a picture of your fish, and they can replicate
that. I don't know
you.
Why people wouldn't just buy Larry the Loudmouth Bass.
Because he sings like cool their, songs.
Yeah. Billy no, the Bass.
Take
is it bass? It's
river.
A bass. I said bass because I don't know.
I'm excited to go back up to Lake Vermilion because it's gorgeous up there, first of all.
It's a great part. It's a beautiful area. It's a family-friendly vacation destination with a lot of rich history. It's
just
actually
the
one of
rocky
the
rocky shores yeah. and the pine. It's like a postcard when you're out there. It's like a Minnesota postcard.
There are actually more than 40,000 acres of water in Lake Vermilion.
Oh, wow.
And it is it just has that rich history, beautiful resorts, mm-hmm. family-owned and operated for more than 30 years, a lot of them. So mm-hmm. it's a great family-friendly vacation destination.
And I would imagine that I know in Minnesota we're so much more environmentally conscious, and because so much of our tourism depends on the nature being nature – you know, and us going to enjoy it, that it's protected a lot. Yeah.
It is
like
very
these,
protected.
A lot of these
yep.
places take
in fact,
care of their.
The other cool aspect of Lake Vermilion specifically is a lot of the shoreline, there's no cabins.
It's undeveloped. Yeah.
It's undeveloped.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and like, there's like
you
a law.
Can go, there are spots out in Lake Vermilion where you won't see another person.
Mm-hmm. You can get your own little islands. There's yep. little islands out
there's
there.
There's 365 islands.
One for every day of the year?
I never thought of that. There's a bucket list.
I'm going to my July 11th island. And I'll see you later.
Yeah, Lake Vermilion is one of the largest lakes in the state.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think yeah. I said that. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So, and you mentioned besides fishing, we're going to be able to take a tour of a mine, to go down half mile underground. What?
That's right. Well, so Lake Vermilion State Park is now combined with Sudan Underground Mine. Lake Vermilion State Park is the newest state park in the state, but it's combined now with Sudan Underground Mine State Park, which has been around for quite a few years. And you can go down into the mine and, you know, really experience what it was like to be a miner back in the day.
Have you done it?
I have not yet, but I was just there the other day and I saw all the groups with their hard hats on, and I think it's about a half hour tour. And there's one
what
point.
What if you freak out when you're down there? What if
that's
you?
What, remember,
it's
I was
pretty
talking
tight
about that the
quarters.
Other day.
It's pretty tight. You take a little, I think it's a trolley or some sort of train down there. But there's one point in the tour where it goes completely dark, and it is the darkest
Mm-mm.
spot you would ever Mm-mm. embrace in your entire life.
Sound good, Tim?
I can't do those.
No. Yeah, me neither.
No, not at
but,
all.
But it's very nope. it's very quintessential to the area. I mean, that yeah. it's you know, up near the range, it's mine country. This
I
is so Minnesota.
It.
Yeah, you can. You can participate on Friday, May 8th. There's mine tours, there's tours of the new state park. You can go golfing. I know you're probably going to go golfing.
Yeah, get up. Have we had a weather report? What is it like up there?
It's beautiful. I was just up on Monday and Tuesday. The ice is completely out.
Oh, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
It's very early this year. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
last couple years, it's been quite a bit late. So yeah. Third time's a charm.
I've been to some governor fishing openers where there's still ice on the lake like a day before.
Oh, wow.
And they're like, what are we going to do?
No, we don't say that. No. Because remember what I said earlier? It's not just about fishing.
Ah,
yeah.
All right.
There we go.
Okay. Yeah, it's.
We still, I mean, I've been.
What are we
going
to do? We're going to have so much more fun.
Yeah, I've been through 2 years
We're
of
gonna media have two bar dances.
About the ice. Yeah.
It's the governor's bard dance. A new tradition begins.
Oh, man.
I feel like your band, like your kind of music, would fit at the barn dance.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We should do a really late night barn dance.
They would be
my,
so
with
shocked.
My music.
After the first song,
they would be offended.
Did she just say? Yeah. What is she saying?
Yeah, I would never be invited back into the state.
So the governor's fishing opener, it will you'll be able to announce next year's destination by the end of the opener, right?
Yeah.
You guys already know?
I do have a little secret, but I cannot share that with you. That will not be officially announced.
Blink
until
twice if it's up north.
She blinked once. Saturday.
She winked at me.
Of the fishing opener, 8:30 p.m. So just, you know, check your email because you'll be getting a press release.
Does the location rhyme with Schmaynard?
It was in the Brainerd Lakes area in 2014. Keep tabs.
Oh,
here.
Sorry. And that's
I'd like you to name every single location since 1948 by the end of this conversation.
Dang, that's gonna. Whoa. What do I win?
You've been to 20 of them.
You've been to 20?
At least 20, yeah.
Do you have any vintage trucker style hats from the 80s that I can borrow? Because I was born in 1983, and I kind of want to do a hashtag TBT photo on a Thursday before the event. So if you have one, can you bring it up for me?
I've got this sweet 80s lipstick I'm wearing.
Me too.
Oh, yeah.
You do wear a little too much, but.
Oh, yeah. No, it's totally too much, but I don't care.
You could use some, Tim.
How about this, though? I just want to ask this serious question. Explore Minnesota, we talked about the fishing opener. What other things, like, in your position, do you do with Explore Minnesota to bring tourism here and stuff? I actually asked that question before you walked in. I was just like, what other things besides fishing and nature to get people to Minnesota for tourism? What kind of things?
Everything. I am the PR person for the state's tourism office, Explore Minnesota, and I promote, I mean, my day is never the same. I promote everything from fishing to craft breweries to wineries, distilleries, golfing, biking.
Nice TV commercial, by the way. The most recent TV commercial looks really good. It's like, I want to live there. Oh, wait, I do.
Yes. Yes, it's beautiful. We have a great brand new campaign, hashtag only in MN. Mm-hmm. It really it captures what is so unique and diverse about our state. It's so cool that you can go from every inch of the state and have a very different experience. Mm-hmm. You know, right here in the Twin Cities, it's a very vibrant culture and arts and entertainment destination. Like I said, craft breweries, wineries. But then just a couple, you know, an hour to a couple of hours north, you're in like a different country with the nature and the lakes and just the outdoor recreation.
I will say, Alyssa,
Lake Superior area is totally different.
Yeah. It's almost like you're on Lake Superior, like you're driving on Highway 1 in California.
California, absolutely. Yeah. So I mentioned before I'm a native Californian, and I basically was not in Minnesota till I was 30. I've spent times on both coasts. I grew up there. And we really have something special that people on the coast just don't even know about. I've been a resident of Minnesota for 7 years now, and I really love it here, like the Twin Cities itself. And that's mostly where I've spent my time, but I have gone out a little bit, you know, into the wilderness and whatnot. And we're so blessed here. And people on the coasts have no idea. It's like this is flyover country when they hear Minnesota. I mean, they know about Chicago or whatnot. They hear about Minnesota, and they're kind of like, a lot of my family and friends from the coast were like, one of my friends was like, you're going to get pregnant and you're, bleh, you know, and I'm like,
that's our reputation.
I don't know. Like, I don't
know.
Or
it's cold all year long.
You're going to be, you're going to settle down. Is that
what
they're saying?
Yes, exactly. Oh, okay. Exactly. That I'm going to settle down and be boring or whatnot. And it's like, this is where I really like honed my performance and have met so many amazing artists as well, and got, including Tim Mahoney, and got to and also got to like just the how beautiful it is here in the winter and in the summer. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. So I am a proud transplant.
Oh, I love to hear that. Yeah. I love hearing that.
7 years, though, she needs another 10 before we can accept her officially as
that's,
a Minnesota.
Yeah, right. That's fine.
Now you're just in transition right now.
Yeah.
I just don't like the cliches I think people say in other states. You know, like I do go to New York, L.A., and people just think it's cold all the time. Uh-huh. We just play hockey and farm. Like I'm just sick of it. They have no idea
because it's ignorance.
Full summers and full. I just don't know.
It is a diamond in the rough.
One of our target markets, our new target markets, is Denver, Colorado.
So
we are, you know, we're doing some great things there.
You want them to bring the weed over?
That's got to be a tough. That's got to be a tough sell. I mean, Denver's got mountains and their own
breathtaking nature. I just had a nice story in last Sunday's Denver Post travel section about our campaign and why we're marketing there. And it's because Denver or Colorado and Minnesota actually have a lot of similarities. We have a lot of – both of us hone our outdoor adventure and our cultural experiences. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Denver might have the 14,000-foot mountains, but we have 12,000 lakes. Mm-hmm. So, and they don't have that many lakes. So we'd like them to come here and kind of experience our summer. And
you know, I always said, and maybe you can work on this. The Twin Cities could use a giant mountain range. That would be awesome.
I'll work on that.
Right there, and then an ocean as well.
We could just use two mountains, and we can call them the Twin Titties.
Oh my God!
Wow. No, nobody likes that. I can't believe you guys.
Open your minds.
How about the music scene, though? Of course, I got to say it. Not just me, but I mean, Minneapolis is known as, you know, one of the top music where people have come from, and especially, you know, the latest hit, Uptown Funk, which
is straight up Minneapolis music.
Finally, you know, gave homage Minneapolis to, sign, yeah. you know, it's so, about yeah. Minneapolis.
We're home to the purple one. I mean, it's a great. You're taking
Why
a picture
are you taking
of
so
me.
Many
I am.
Thank you. Hi.
I'm just taking.
Well,
taking
tell her maybe so she can.
Well,
like,
I just did.
Which, by the way, did you know it's 30th there year? It's been 30 years since Raspberry Beret.
30 years?
It's been
this is
30
my
years
favorite.
Since Raspberry Beret came out. This is John Mayer doing Raspberry Beret.
That's John Mayer?
Yeah.
He held a door open for me once.
Oh, that's that's nice.
I saw him the night when he was at Bunkers with Jessica Simpson.
What?
Yeah.
Just hanging out?
That's right.
He stopped in. They stopped into Bunkers.
I love Bunkers.
And he got up and played with Mambo's Combo.
Where's Bunkers? Is that downtown?
It's in the North Loop.
Wow. Oh, okay.
What? How do you
and
not know that?
You said you're Minnesotan.
You're not Minnesotan yet if you don't know
where
you're
from. Another 10 years.
Yeah, exactly. I'm still discovering stuff.
Let's have you been to Valley Fair?
I have been to Valley Fair. Once.
Have you been outside of the Twin Cities?
Yes. Okay, good. I have been, yeah. Okay. I've been.
St. Paul?
That's the Twin Cities.
Oh, that's true. Never mind.
I've been to like Red Wing. I've been to Rochester.
Oh,
I've been to Glencoe. I spent Christmas in Glencoe this past year. Oh. Yeah, I know.
High five, Harbfields.
I'm from northern Minnesota, the International Falls area. I grew up just 2 miles from Voyageurs National Park boundaries.
And what brought you down to the cities?
College.
Okay. Yeah. What
I came down here about 13 years ago. I went to the University of Minnesota.
Cool. Is that where you went? Didn't you go to U or
I went to Madison, Wisconsin.
Oh.
Grew up in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Badger E. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, and then I would come back and visit my buddies at the U and go, really? You guys are playing football in the dome?
Gopher Nation.
Mm. Yeah, go to Camp Randall on a Saturday and see what happens.
You went to the KK.
College Club, yeah. I love Madison. All right, let's wrap up the I know you've got many interviews to do today. Thank you for coming in and enlightening.
Are you doing like an interview, like, what do they call that, junket? No.
I feel like I'm on a media tour this
morning.
I had two interviews before 8:30, and I have another one right after this. So 4 before noon. I'm feeling really productive today.
Yeah, awesome. Mm-hmm. Awesome. You're providing lots of information, so you're doing it really well.
Oh, thank you.
The show's going to be up there that Thursday, May 7th, right? We're going to check in, and we'll be broadcasting live that Friday, we think from like 8 to 10
Friday
in the morning.
Friday morning, 8 to 10. Ooh. It's going to be a big – I mean, I have 15 radio stations signed up to broadcast simultaneously. And I think there'll be more.
Cool.
What about an Explore Minnesota jingle? Did we do that at all?
They have one. Do you have one that you'd like to?
Maybe could I just give a sample?
Yeah.
Please? Do you have a jingle?
Tim's a songwriter. He's going
to
pitch you.
If you'd like to come up with one, I can maybe pitch it to our advertising
I'll just start right here.
Let's hear it.
Okay.
Explore Minnesota. It's so dang beautiful. Won't you explore Minnesota? We're going to have so much fun at the fishing opener this year with the governor and the PR girl. We're going to have so much fun. Explore Minnesota. Explore Minnesota.
Yay. That was beautiful.
You got a mention in it. I mean, he actually put you in the song.
Yeah,
I didn't want to put your name, you know, because I didn't know.
In case there's another PR girl for next year, you want to keep the song
wow,
green.
That hurts. That hurts bad.
That's kind of hurt.
Sorry. There'll never be another one.
They can't replace
Let's not
me.
Leave. No. I'm not that bad. I want to make it up.
Okay.
Okay.
Don't ask me to marry you ever.
That happened before the show already.
I said, ooh, I said, growl. Can I sing at your wedding? That was what I really meant.
Oh, boy.
He said, you said, do you want to get married?
Yeah.
And then you said, not necessarily to me.
Your memory is too good.
Mm. Your delivery is too
good. And I'm a pothead. Who knew?
Not on.
You're going to be so busy, you won't be fishing, will you, at the opener?
I won't get to fish not as much as you, no.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit too busy because I have to corral all you media folk.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Herding
cats.
I have to make
sure
you are on point, and then I have to schedule interviews for all y'all, and I got to make sure everybody gets to their interviews on time. Mm. You're going to see me with, like, 3 phones, and...
You're like Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, we're going to do the broadcast Friday morning. We're going to go to that picnic. Probably hit the barn dance Thursday night. I'm probably going to need
it. Yeah.
I want to get out on a boat.
Are you registered?
Fishing license registered?
No, for the opener. The deadline's tomorrow.
Yeah, no, we spoke. I'm going to do that today.
Yeah, you're going to do that today.
I'm going to do that today. Can the folks hear your dog? She keeps trying to get out of bite.
She's so cute.
All right. Yeah. I will register today. It's going to be a fun-filled weekend, and the weather's going to be gorgeous, and I'm going to catch fish, right?
You're going to catch fish.
All right. Mm.
All right. Well, thanks.
Thank you for having me, guys.
Thank
you,
Melissa.
If you've got other things to do, you can do whatever. It's going to get R-rated now, though, and I'm afraid you might
get upset. I might need to take off.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a Northwoods girl.
Oh, wait.
So.
Were we not supposed to be R-rated while she was here?
We were PG-13. We were okay.
She might have to use a clip, you know, for her PR stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know.
Oh, okay. Fair.
My boss might never let me come back.
No.
She's like, skip that show.
We can have you back on to talk about your secret life hobbies, whatever they may be.
Sure.
Like building model airplanes or.
Well, I just live in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. And I like to bike and run.
What kind of music?
There you
I
go.
Don't like to build model airplanes. Oh, okay. I'm not very good at that.
What kind of music do you like?
I like all kinds of music.
What's the last thing you bought or stole or streamed?
I've been really listening to Sam Hunt and Florida Georgia Line lately.
Oh, so country. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Oh, very cool.
And Trampled by Turtles. I'm going to my actually first Trampled by Turtles show in August in Colorado at Red Rocks.
Awesome. Oh, shut
up.
Can
you believe that? My first experience, a Minnesota band at Red Rocks.
That's
you never seen a concert at Red Rocks?
No.
It's cool.
No,
it's
very I'm
cool.
so excited.
I've never seen one either. Mm-hmm. And
we have the same agent. They're very cool guys, too.
Oh,
really
yeah.
nice guys.
Yeah, they're cool guys. They
Tim,
cool guys.
The bassist, called me an artist after he saw us play once. That
wow.
felt really good.
Like a good artist or just
yeah,
an artist?
He was like, you're an artist. And I was like, thanks, man. That's my claim to fame.
Of course, Rusty wouldn't play something like actually Trampled by Turtles.
He's I don't have it. I don't have it.
Play something.
The
what did you think of that?
Locked
real
and
quick, country fan, what did you think of the ACMs?
Oh, I love the ACMs. Yeah.
What was some of your favorite stuff from there? Just a lot of, there's been a lot of press about the Country Music Awards, and I like to get people's opinion about who they liked. And
I loved when Garth Brooks performed. I'm just a diehard Garth Brooks fan.
What did you think?
He's legendary.
He's one of the nicest
I can
interviews.
Even get behind him.
I've interviewed him like 6 times.
Best
and he's
concert
so nice.
I've ever been to at the Target Center last fall. It was great.
What did you think of the Christina Rascal Flatts thing?
Oh, I thought that was okay.
Okay.
I mean, I think I was expecting a little more. But,
okay.
But it was
the
fine.
First little section they did, they kind of did that preliminary kind of intro. I thought that was really cool. So they did a song called Riot. But the first thing they did was a little song. And
did it go like this?
I knew you were going to do that.
Didn't? A little like this?
How about... So if we did write an Explore jingle, would it have to be country then? Or
no.
No. Okay.
All right.
Right now, our promotional... pieces on television are using a lot of Minnesota musicians and artists and stuff.
Awesome.
Yeah, we pride ourselves on using our Minnesota faves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think I'm a little bit of a favorite somewhere, but I've done a couple Minnesota things. What's the thing I did for Care 11? I did Minnesota Own Backyard when they did the new backyard, did like kind of their jingle thing.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe I could just give you my card and I'll make up a little something and see if you like it.
Okay.
That's all I'm asking.
Keep your work off my program. Don't have to be doing deals on my show.
I just wanted to let her know I'm actually, I have a serious side.
Yeah, I like that we have the deal happening here. I mean, because who knows what the future is going to hold.
Right.
And we got it first on the Twin Cities Hit Show. I mean.
All right. Alyssa, we're going to take a break.
Thank you for having me.
I look forward to, I'm really excited to be up there. It's going to be a good fishing opener, right?
Sounds good. We're going to have a real, quote unquote, good time.
Nice. Mm. We got to take a break.
R-E-E-L. I get it.
That was good.
The Twin Cities Hit Show with Rusty, Courtney, and Chuck. We'll be right back.
MacMen. Don't let your computer problems drive you mad. We are MacMen, Minnesota's premier tech consultants and problem solvers for Macs, mobile devices, troubleshooting, training, and much more. No more dragging your computer all over town because we come to you. We love making house calls to your home or small business. MacMen. Call 612-345-8005. The Alive and Social Network is alive and growing. From the best in sports, music, movies, and beer, Alive and Social is what all the cool kids click on. Featuring characters like Radio Rebel Jeff DeBay, Star Tribune pundit Jim Suhan Unfiltered, and television veteran and handsome man Rusty Gatenby. You can also taste the Minnesota Pubcast with Jason and Molly. Join the band with Live Band Karaoke Night from legendary O'Gara's in St. Paul and the Live Music Showcase from Shamrocks. Yes, Alive and Social Network does indeed rock and roll. The Jeff DeBay Show, Jim Suhan Unfiltered, the Rusty Gatenby Review, the Minnesota Pubcast with Jason and Molly, Live Band Karaoke, and Shamrock's Live Music Showcase. Join the fun. Be alive and social with the Alive and Social Network.
What are you drinking tonight, Jason?
The Minnesota Pubcast with Jason and Molly.
I'm drinking a Lethbridge Hop Dish.
It's Pub Talk from a Minnesotan perspective.
I'm always really proud of where I'm from. I'm super proud of Minnesota, and I think Minneapolis is awesome. I think St. Paul is awesome. I think we're a really awesome cultural epicenter.
With great local guests.
So the other voice you hear in the room today is Jerry Fagerberg from the City Pages. Talk about the official Minnesota Tall Boy, which your piece is on the cover of the City Pages.
It is on the cover. Came out today.
Talking movies.
All right, you saw Boyhood. I need to hear what you thought.
Oh, man. Oh, man.
Wow.
Sports.
A guy who was undrafted knew what was coming.
And everything else you talk about at the pub.
Let's not pretend like we know what we're talking about.
Well, what do you think I do every show?
The Minnesota Pubcast with Jason McGovern and Molly Burke. Listen at mnpubcast.com or subscribe on iTunes.
We want to just find meaning in life.
Oh, that's a wrong bumping. Dang it. All right. Son of a...
Because it's Thursday.
Yeah. There we go. We'll just come back with this. Sorry.
This is Rye Cooter?
Can you please stop that? I mean, you have nothing else in your computer this morning. And now I can now I can be my real
Why
self.
Why is your computer so empty?
Reprimanded me with the Explore Minnesota girl.
Oh. Reprimanded you.
My computer's so empty because I knew that we were going to talk a lot.
Yeah.
DNR late.
Oh, yeah,
or,
that's
fine. DNR late.
I was making fun of your computer.
I know. I was like, I was up late last night putting two shows together.
Loli wants to get on. Look at her. She's like.
She's been talking. She wants to say something.
What's up, buddy?
So we just got an email from
What's
a listener.
Up, girl?
What did the listener say?
The listener. We have a listener, Jeremy Kay.
Yeah.
Who said, 7 consecutive broadcasts listened to, and I learned to love myself.
Way to go. Wow.
I'm really, really happy that that is what's happening with our listeners.
Now, me They're being, if I'm going to interview you guys, because I'm normally not on here, why do you think that is? Why do you think he might have got that from your show?
Probably because we are such awful people, and he's listening, and he's like, I'm not so bad.
That's a good point.
This leads me into, have you seen the Amy Schumer skit where she's jogging in the woods?
No. Wait, is this from the Friday Night Lights No, well, go ahead.
That's a different
You're talking
one.
About, okay.
I'm going to do that one tomorrow, I think. But
yeah.
This one, she's jogging through the woods, and she comes across a very picturesque picnic table out in the woods. And there's Tina Fey, Julie Louis-Dreyfus, and Academy Award winner Patricia Arquette.
Yes.
And they're having just a picnic. And here's oh my dang computer. Let's see if I can get this to work.
I love that
we
keep
saw
talking.
The clips. Here we go. It's about yeah, I get it.
I love that we keep talking about Amy Schumer, that Amy Schumer keeps coming up on this show.
You know, I search the internets to find what's trending and stuff, and yeah. This one is trending. Here we go.
Oh, all right.
And the flawless introduction to the Amy Schumer clip.
I'm sorry. I love all of you. I can't believe you're here. You're like literally my heroes.
God, you look familiar. Are you that girl from the television who talks about her pussy all the time?
Yes! That is, yes, thank you.
How fun. Well, come sit.
Please.
Come on.
Yeah?
Come talk about your pussy over here.
Is it someone's birthday or?
Oh. Kind of the opposite. We're celebrating Julia's last fuckable day.
Yes.
Salute.
Sorry, did you say Julia's last fuckable day? Mm-hmm. What is that? Mm.
In every actress's life, the media decides when you finally reach the point where you're not believably fuckable anymore.
I mean, how do you know? Who tells you?
Well, nobody really overtly tells you, but there are signs. How Sally Field was Tom Hanks' love interest in Punchline, and then like 20 minutes later she was his mom in Forrest Gump?
Or you knocked it off with a rom-com with Jack Nicholson where you're competing with another woman to fuck him. Or I just had an audition for Mrs. Claus.
You're kidding me.
I read for that part.
I read for that too.
You did? Yes.
Hey, who got that?
J-Lo.
Oh, she'll be good.
She's going to be really good.
Really good.
Mm. Or you go to a movie set, you go to wardrobe, and the only thing they have for you to wear are long sweaters. Like, cover you up head to toe kind of thing.
Where, like, the poster for your movie is just like a picture of the kitchen.
Yeah.
With these very uplifting and yet vague titles like Whatever It Takes or She Means Well. That kind of thing, right? Mm-hmm.
Another common sign is when they start remaking your best movies with younger, more fuckable actresses. I guess they're remaking Boyhood with Selena Gomez at my part.
That's gonna make a lot of money.
I don't understand. You're all so fuckable.
Like, believe me, no one was more surprised than me that they let me stay fuckable throughout my 40s, and the fact that it continued into my 50s. This was just like, thanks, but I thought that Us Weekly had made some sort of a clerical error or something.
Tell me about it. If you shoot a sex scene the night before your birthday, everyone is like, hurry up, we gotta get it before midnight, because we think your vagina is gonna turn into a hermit crab.
Uh-huh. Well, is there anything you can do to delay it?
Yeah, I mean, you can try, but it only makes it worse. Like those Real Housewives. They try to look young, but then they end up looking like a purse that melted in a car accident.
Yeah.
They look like when a kid draws a face on its hand.
But what about men? Like, who tells men when it's their last fuckable day?
Honey, men don't have that day.
Never. Well, they're fuckable forever. They could be 100 and like nothing but white spiders coming out, but they're fuckable.
I didn't get this commercial last week for AARP because the director said I was too old to play Larry King's wife.
I heard that Bruce Willis just got engaged to a girl who is 24 years younger than him, and I heard that she's an actual baby lamb.
What?
Really?
I'm Google it.
So wait, are you guys like bummed at all?
What? No, are you kidding me? I'm thrilled. Ecstatic. I mean, I don't have to deal with this, maintaining this anymore. I mean, it's just it's a godsend. I can grow my pubes out. Look at this. See, this ice cream's been sitting out here for an hour. You want to know why? Watch this, baby. Chug, 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 chug.
Anyway, I thought that was awesome, especially the caliber of talent she gets to play along with.
Right, yeah.
My opinion, I got a couple opinions, see if you guys share it.
All right.
Not to make it a serious note, but I think
it
is true, like Hollywood, we talk about that. There is certain parts you get.
Mm-hmm.
My opinion is a couple things. If you can truly stay, well, again, that's an opinion, of course, but stay attractive and hot, you can get those roles later. I feel like some of the screw-ups that happen is, you know, all the lipo and all the lip stuff, and I mean...
Yeah.
I don't know. That's just my opinion.
Well, I think that the lipo and the lip stuff and all the plastic surgery comes from sort of a cultural, cultural insinuation that women are not good enough when they get older, when the older stuff starts happening.
Sandra Bullock just said that article out. Did you see that article about her? She's just got named the most beautiful girl or whatever. Mm-hmm. I think it's People's.
Yeah.
And they were talking about her daughter made a little statement saying,
Sandra
Mommy, what are those lines on your face? And she said, you know, those are from laughing.
Yeah.
And those are from living. And, mm-hmm. and you know, her kid was like, wow, I want to be like that someday. Mm-hmm. And it was
yeah.
just, it was a beautiful thing.
It's, well, I mean, when you think about like just like all beauty ads and all these sort of different products that are available for women to like erase lines and then Photoshop. I mean, there's all the things we all know about already that I love that Sandra Bullock said that to her daughter that yes, crow's
the
feet.
Son, I think. Son?
Son? Son? I'm sorry.
I want to check that.
Oh,
I
don't know. Okay.
She adopted a boy.
Oh, okay.
With that biker dude that things went
oh,
wrong.
Oh, Jesse James. Yeah.
That was a weird one. I was like, what?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but
what's
that.
What's going on there?
Yeah. I like that, you know, I mean, it's gradual, but you wouldn't have heard a woman saying that to her son or daughter even in the 70s or 80s. I mean, my mother was saying things to me that were, I can't think of anything right off. In fact, the only thing that sticks out that my mom said was that I didn't need makeup when I was 13 because I was beautiful enough. So,
oh,
you know,
that's good.
I don't know. I'm like, what? Wait.
And now
what
look at you.
Yeah, now look at me. I'm wearing this hot pink lipstick, too much of it.
You need a boatload of makeup now.
Yeah.
I'm going to kiss it.
Yeah.
Wow. She's got a boyfriend. Yeah, she's got a boyfriend.
Mm. Who came home yesterday, by the by.
There you go. Things good. Things
happy.
Things are great.
Like a 3-day bender. Or?
No, he was in the UK on tour actually for a couple weeks.
Okay.
There you go. Cool. Speaking of music, I knew that you were coming in, Tim, on your Thursday visit.
Yeah.
And what was your first album that you bought?
Okay. First album that I bought, I believe was. Now I had an older brother, of course, so you're always influenced by your older brother,
oh, yeah.
especially.
Yeah.
And he's 5 years older. So, and we were actually buying albums, and I believe it was the B-52s.
Oh wow!
Which one?
It was actually
Rock
not the. It was a second record, just called Wild Planet.
Mm-hmm.
It's a red album cover, and my brother was into a lot of. I've talked about the Van Halen stuff, but also a lot of the new wave stuff. So like B-52s, mm-hmm. the Tubes,
mm-hmm.
And
the Tubes.
Yeah, you remember that?
Oh yeah, yeah.
But the B-52s, and I just remember thinking the music was just, you know, out of this world. Like mm-hmm. I thought they were from another.
Did you
planet.
Ever? Did you ever go that direction with your musical?
I didn't really, but I remember also that was my first concert, and why this is a good story. Lowly mm-hmm. agrees. So this is from the first record, Rock Lobster,
yeah.
of course. My brother brought me to the Northrop. Now, remember, you're 5 years younger, so didn't really want to bring me. But I ended up being behind someone smoking pot, and I started to get sick. Well, I started to throw up on the way out.
Ooh.
But my brother was so embarrassed, he was trying to run away from me.
Oh.
And I was crying, going, Mark, come back. And he was
That's
with
a
his,
horrible story.
I know, isn't it? He was with his buddies, and he's like, my little brother's
How old
puking.
You?
Maybe like 10 or 11.
Yeah? Oh, yeah.
19?
last year.
Oh. Yeah, that would be the age. He would be 15 or 16 and totally embarrassed.
Exactly.
Of his younger
brother. He's like, I get it, though, because when I was 16, I could see that. I mean, it was like, really?
Yeah.
My little brother's going to be throwing up in front of my friends.
Because mm-hmm. he can't handle some marijuana.
Right.
Weird Al answered this question. What was your first album? And I came across that mm-hmm. on the internet. Here's what he said. I thought it was kind of cool.
Hey, I'm Weird Al Yankovic, and this is my first album. I think the first album that I ever bought with my own money was Goodbye Yellow Brick Road by Elton John. It wasn't my first album, period. My parents had gotten me Kitty Records and various other things they found to pick and save for the bargain bin. But the one first album that I ever really wanted to own was Elton John. I was slightly obsessed at that point. I figured at that age, 12, 13 years old, you're supposed to be obsessed about some pop star. Mm-hmm. And Elton John seemed appropriate. And I really liked Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting and Funeral for a Friend, Love Life Bleeding, and some of the other songs on the album. So I bought it, and I basically memorized it. I taught myself how to play rock and roll on the accordion by listening to that album over and over. I charted out all the songs. I figured out the chord progressions. And I learned the whole album from top to bottom. And that was one of the ways I learned that you can rock out on the accordion. I guess I got a thank Elton for that. My sister looks cute
and her bridges and boots. Not an unusual choice. I mean, you know, Elton John's, mm-hmm. the Beatles, you know.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I say this, I came across and I was like, oh, that's interesting. And then I started listening to Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, which I have album and CD, but I haven't listened to it in like 10, 15 years. I forgot how amazingly awesome he kind of took the baton from the Beatles as far as concept albums and some incredible music on that.
Do you disagree, Tim?
No, I'm kind of shaking my head saying just, I was more just even going to say like the piano vocal thing too, which of course was big in the 70s, but like... Just some really, really strong, you know, him partnering up with, what's his name?
Bernie Taupin. Listen to how this album opens, though. I mean, they don't do stuff like this anymore.
No, because people would stop listening, right?
This is a pop star. I could see Lady Gaga maybe trying
to. Yeah, Lady Gaga, like Born This Way starts out very similar to this.
Just think of how high people were listening to this, too.
I wasn't, but what my routine was, my parents had a pool table in the pool room, and I would lay under the pool table and put the speakers on either side of me and lay in this sound cocoon. And when this stuff started happening, I was just like in another place.
Totally. Oh my God, with the two speakers on either side, holy crap.
Totally straight, wasn't high.
Oh yeah, no,
but
no.
Went there.
But that's the beautiful thing about great music is that you don't need drugs to like experience it and like totally go there mental. It's like a different kind of meditation when you really.
Yeah.
Tim, weren't you just talking about this on Facebook? You were like, when's the last time you really listened to music?
Yeah,
really
that's right.
Listened to an album?
Yeah, I mean, this is something that's a part of me that I was just kind of showing. It was I got home late and I was just like, I just enjoy, and I'm surely not saying I'm different or better. I just, you know, I'll sit in my car at least a couple hours a week and just play music.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes that's much more therapy than actually writing or performing. And I'll search different genres.
That's a great.
I want to hear stuff. And I feel like every week I'm looking for that one song that kind of is like a day or week changer. And I'm always searching for that one. And I was just curious if people do it like that. Now, people say I listen to music.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, but just really take it in. How do you interpret the song? How does it make you feel?
What different instruments are you hearing? Like,
yeah. And maybe not be the musician, too. That's the thing, is not go, wow, that bass could be louder. Or just be like, no, this is just really good. This is just good.
Yeah, I feel like it's like space-like.
Yeah. Everyone, if you don't own it, go buy Yellow Brick Road.
My parents have this album, this vinyl. I don't remember listening to it, but...
It's a two-album set.
Yeah.
And he tried to do... A story almost. It's almost a rock opera.
Yeah.
I just forgot.
Yeah, how long are we in here? No vocal yet or anything?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I just forgot how awesome the album was.
You know, there's a
here
band.
Here we go. Here comes your piano. Yeah, and he hasn't started singing yet.
Yeah.
They don't make them like they used to, see? When I was a kid, Yellow Brick Road.
I was just going to mention, there's a great album that came out a few years ago by a band called the Decembrists.
Yeah.
And the album was called The Hazards of Love. And it was a concept story album where all the songs, it was a rock opera, all the songs, like, told a story together. And it started out with a long instrumental bit in the beginning, and I actually saw them perform it, the whole album, at Rock the Garden a few years ago, and it was, I mean, the album itself is It's not quite as large as this, but it is very, I mean, it definitely it tells a story. It takes you to another land.
Yep.
So are you familiar with that album, Tim?
A little bit.
Yeah.
I think I have.
They have new music coming out the December.
Yeah. Yeah, they've got some new stuff since then. That's the last one I'm really familiar with. But that particular album is a concept album that tells a story and has like a long beginning to it where there's no vocals. So,
right.
Yeah.
And he's about to start singing, and he takes the song. There's been like three turns on the song so far. Very Beatle-like. Very Abbey Road.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like he had snippets of ideas, and then he just found a way to make it one musical journey.
And I guess my point was is that people are still doing
this. Oh, cool. Yeah. I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm just going to wait till he starts singing.
And we'll be here all week.
You don't like Yellow Brick Road?
No, I love it. No, I'm just saying I just still am fascinated because I maybe come from the side of just...
And Elton doesn't make music like this anymore either.
Yet, maybe he will again.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure someone's telling him not that he doesn't have control, but like, you know, people maybe wouldn't be interested in who's, you know, we're talking about it, but I don't know how many people are anymore.
Yeah. He should bring it back.
Yeah. Let's get Elton here.
I want to
sit him down.
I just tweeted at him, so hopefully he'll click on the link and listen to our show and hear we're talking about him. And Elton John, if you're listening right now, please come on our show.
We want you in. I'm going to get to that one.
Okay, that's right.
Remember this one, though? You just did a piano CD, didn't you?
That was instrumental during the holidays.
Really?
Yep. Just background music. When I think of those See, that's the stuff I love, the piano, vocal, singer-songrewriter. Like, that's some emotion that, you know, we don't get as much. The Billy Joel. Most recently, the Bruno Mars song, When I Was Your Man, was some statistic because it was just piano vocal. The last time a piano vocal song was number one was like in the 70s, and I think it was Billy Joel's.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You've Got a Way.
She's Got a Way, yeah.
She's Got a Way, thank you.
Someone saved, someone saved. Someone saved my life tonight. Sugar Bear. All right. So, my Wrecking Ball, why do you like this one?
Well, I'm just looking at Ryan Adams' My Wrecking Ball Live.
Got it, got it. Oh, live.
Yeah, it's like a radio show. And it just talking about these songs that can, you know, change your week.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this song was on his newest record.
Mm-hmm.
But again, when I heard it, I was just like, it just engulfed me.
Mm-hmm.
It was one of these things where the lyrics, and I don't know, there's a melancholy to it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's like that sadness, but then there's also like, I was like, wow. This is what life is about. This is what listening, and this is what, particularly me, keeps me breathing. I mean, when I hear stuff like this.
Here is Ryan Adams performing the song My Wrecking Ball from his brand new self-titled record in Studio Q.
It's just no question. It's just pure emotion.
Driving through the streets tonight, Todd got the windows down. I wish I could call you, I wish you were still around. Nothing much left in the tank. Somehow this thing still drives. Like it forgot what it needed, but somehow still survived.
And the little B3 organ coming in here is just great.
And all the walls we built, they must come down. Hey, my wrecking ball, won't you come and maybe knock me down?
Sounds great. He needs a haircut, though.
Hey, my wrecking ball, won't you come and maybe knock me down? Well, you know what? That's the part. He's kind of a damaged guy, and there's part of it that...
My wrecking
as a listener, we like to hear that. Maybe like the guy who wrote in, we want to hear people that are real and have real stories, that have problems. And, and that's why I think I like Ryan Adams, because he's like everybody else. He's got some issues, and he writes it out in his songs, and it maybe makes me feel better. Not to make that a heavy statement for your fan, but maybe he liked the show because it helped him, because you guys just sound like regular people.
Yeah,
you
know? Absolutely.
And you know, you just say what you feel. Now, sure, it might be obnoxious or crazy, but in real life, that's the way people are, though, right?
Absolutely. People are obnoxious and crazy.
That's Courtney's role, to be obnoxious and crazy. I'm the sane, normal one.
Yes, but even you, Rusty, I mean, you've been on conservative stuff. I mean, being real is people hear that. Mm-hmm. People always talk about listeners. How smart are they? Well, I say they're smarter than musicians.
Well, here's the thing also. In improv, you are taught to play to the top of the audience's intelligence. And we need to, I mean, how smart are our listeners? Let's just assume they're really smart.
Right.
Yeah. Courtney's pretty smart. And it's Courtney's time now.
I'm okay.
Give me your time.
It's my time. I almost want you to just play the Tori Amos song that I was like curled up in a fetal position with a couple months ago. It's off of her latest album. The song is called Selkie, and it's not a sad song, but it's a slow song. But it's this beautiful song. So Selkie is the legend of the seal that turns into a human. It's sort of like almost a mermaid. Mythology,
I'm actually buying it right now.
Yeah, it's
the one thing I like to do is again listen to people's ideas and buy stuff.
It's really such a beautiful song. Are you looking it up? Are we gonna
what's
play
the,
it?
What's the record?
No, it's the record is called.
Is this it?
Yeah, the record is called Unrepentant Geraldines.
Selkie unzips her skin, finally determined. Through a window in the dark, there he sits all alone. I've been waiting on waiting on his Selkie to come back, he said.
That's cool.
So, the story is
she almost
just
went into Maya he, Maya ha ha.
The story is just that the Selkie, the seal woman, is watching her long, long lost love through the window in his house on the beach or whatnot, and she makes the decision, this is the man I want to be with. And so she comes onto the shore, unzips her skin, because the legend of the Selkie is that they unzip their seal skin, and then the person they decide to be with keeps their seal skin locked away in a cabinet. So so by the end of the song, she's talking about how her seal skin is in his cabinet, and she's decided to spend the rest of her life with him.
Who put this in here?
I have
what
chills.
What the hell is in this closet? Ew!
I have
Who
chills.
Who is this?
So, anyway, that's the song that I really listened to most recently, and I was like,
all right,
so
we have just
2
minutes left. I want to play one now. Here's the one I played for you.
I want to play one. Rusty goes like a little kid.
I want to play
one.
I played this for you the other day off camera, and I used it on the Rusty Gave Me Review, but Tim, you might like it. Name this song.
When you were here before,
I already saw the version. It's the girl that did the Creep version, the Radiohead song. And I saw it come out, and I did listen to it right away because a lot of people tried to cover it. But this is one of the better, and it's not, you know, it's this take back to the 40s kind of. And it's like,
I think she sounds gorgeous.
You know what it says too is this is how we do with songs. It's like when a melody is good, it can be a lot of different genres.
Yeah.
I like the two horns. Almost in New Orleans.
It's like blues. Or what is that? What is that old, like... You're right, it is very 50s.
Stand-up bass, grand piano, and two horns.
I
don't care
if it hurts. I love that she comes in first with this voice, and you're kind of like... You're like, okay, I've heard this voice, but then she like does that growling thing, and yeah, that is great.
Well,
that song's not down. That's not. I looked. It's not out. That's what I was mad about. I couldn't find it.
Oh, you can.
Oh,
I couldn't find it on iTunes. That's my only thing with YouTube sometimes.
Yeah.
Is I love it, but then I'll look for that version to buy, and then it's like I can't. So I got to listen to it on YouTube.
Well, this became an interesting half hour for us.
Yeah, I loved it. I loved it.
A little more serious, but good music.
Little music hour.
Yeah.
We are out of time, but we got a big show coming up tomorrow.
Yeah. Isaac Whitty.
I was looking at his stand-up when he was on Conan.
Mm-hmm.
Hilarious.
Yeah.
Hilarious. And you've got a show.
I do have a new show called Being Mahoney. It airs every Thursday. It's comedy fun, more music news.
You're a twisted dude.
A little bit. I forgot really quick, though. I got to get this one in.
Yeah.
I got a message. I know Rusty had a little thing in the paper yesterday.
Oh, I did. Yeah.
He did. CJ from Star Trib wrote about him. But he's got a lot of fans out there that love him.
Oh, really?
And I got...
Someone called in?
Well, someone called in to my kind of hotline.
Oh, okay.
And I just wanted to play it quick for you.
Put it up to the mic. I hope it's nice. Don't hit me when I'm down here.
Just wait. No,
I need to go to my happy place.
I think it's nice. No, I think it's. I think it is. Let's hear it.
I'm worried.
Hello, I'm calling for Rusty Gate and me. This is Debbie Duchanahan. I'm calling to say I saw the article yesterday in the Star Tribune. And what CJ wrote about you. I know some of it you didn't like a little bit, and it didn't seem very nice. My husband, Bert Bassesmacher, used to be a janitor where he used to work, so we would spy on all your conversations. I know the real truth, Rusty, and you're a good man. So I thank you, and thanks for your new show, Bitch Cities, Bitch Show, or Hit Show, no, Hit Show. Thank you. Bye-bye.
That was very nice of her.
That was nice.
Thanks,
see,
Deborah.
Rusty, I told you, you got fans.
Yeah.
I have one fan. All right, we are out of time. We got to go. Tim, thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having
your
me.
Your show.
Being Mahoney, every Thursday we do it live at 3:30, but then we push it out after that. It's only a half-hour show, but we do some comedy skits, Sean and I. We also do some spotlight artists, kind of like we did today. I show some artists to download, and I do some music news, and we just have fun with it.
Very cool.
All right.
Thanks again for being on the show, Tim. Thanks to Alyssa Ebel. From the Explore Minnesota.
Yeah. We'll see her up north. Mm-hmm. And we'll see you guys all tomorrow. The Twin Cities Hit Show. Hope Chuck is having fun. Chuck.
Miss you, Chuck.
Bye-bye.
It's over. The hit show is over. You've been listening to the Twin Cities Hit Show with Rusty, Courtney, and Chuck. Now go home, unless you're already home.